When we want to start making changes to our mental health or our mental health challenges, one of the first things that we need to do is really understand what's going on for us. We need to take a look at our patterns and what's sort of typically going on and what's kind of perpetuating the challenge so that we can start figuring out where to intervene or where to start making some changes. My name is Thomas Brown, and I'd like to talk to you today about the cognitive model for anxiety. As I've said in some of my other videos, I want to remind you that these videos are self-help videos, and they are not designed to replace professional counseling therapy with a psychologist or a social worker or a psychotherapist or a counselor. If you're feeling overwhelmed and unsafe, I really recommend that you call 911 or go to your local emergency room. If you're feeling heightened emotion, but it feels like you're safe, you might need to call a local agency, including Qualia Counseling Services, or contact a therapist if you've already got one, to make sure that you're working on this in a way that's really useful for you. If this is a problem that is less acute and something that you'd maybe go to the bookstore and pick up a store to address, then probably this self-help video is for you. So with that being said, let's take a look again at the cognitive model, kind of generally speaking, and then we can take a look at how it pertains to anxiety. So I'm just throwing this up on the screen here. So here's the cognitive model as a quick reminder for those of you who haven't seen some of the previous content. The cognitive model takes a look at a situation, that's not on here, but it starts with a situation and then it goes first to our thoughts. How are we understanding that situation? What's the story that we're putting on it? How are we impacted by it? And then those thoughts will influence how we feel, what we do, and how our body responds to it. All of the arrows are bidirectional because each thing influences each other. And sometimes it may not start with a thought, but in the cognitive model, it very often does. And so that's often where we'll begin. So how does this pertain to anxiety? Well, here's how this looks. And you'll see in my little bubble in the upper left-hand side that we've got fight, flight, or freeze. Anxiety is all about fight, flight, or freeze. It's an emotion that we've got to help us to mobilize all of our resources and stave off danger, sort of make sure that we're protected. And so when we look at this model, we'll sort of see how this looks. So when it comes to our thoughts with anxiety, people who are quite anxious are going to kind of look around their world and interpret things as fearful or dangerous. They're going to see that, you know, a dark alley is a very dangerous place. It might be, but also they might see kind of a picturesque alley as a dangerous thing as well. And they're going to have kind of be quite sensitive to danger. And maybe if you can kind of think about it like an alarm system with a very thin trigger. You know, it will go off a lot in a lot of different situations. And then also on the flip side, people who are anxious often kind of underestimate or don't think very highly of their ability to cope. So they're seeing danger everywhere and they're thinking, I'm not going to be able to cope. I don't have resources within me to help me, and I don't have much around me to help me either in terms of people or kind of external resources I can draw on. So that leads to a lot of anxiety. And you can see that on that next box over, the right hand box there, that's the emotions box, and that'll come up with fear and anxiety. Sometimes it can be frustration or irritability, sometimes it can be some other emotions, but those will be the predominant ones. We're seeing danger everywhere, I'm thinking of myself, I can't cope with this, I'm going to feel anxiety and fear, maybe overwhelm, and that sort of thing over on that side. If we follow it through down to the bottom box, a major part of anxiety is avoidance. And really, I could make my own, another little diagram, another little cycle for the avoidance cycle. Because what happens is we're starting to think, you know, all right, going to the dentist is horrible and anxiety provoking. It's going to be the worst thing in the world and I can't handle it. That might be my thinking. So of course, when I think about the dentist or go to the dentist, oh, I'm so anxious and scared. So then what am I going to do? Well, I'm not going to go to the dentist. And how does that impact me? Well, my anxiety goes down. Whew, that feels better. I don't have to go. But then, of course, secondary problems arise. It might be that my teeth start rotting or I need some work done and I can't. But also, for more of that cognitive point of view, we don't learn. We don't learn that the dentist maybe isn't that catastrophic place to go. We might learn that it isn't so bad. You know, it's not the best place in the world to go. Sorry, dentists. But it's, you know, it's not so bad to go there, have your teeth cleaned. And really, even getting a cavity filled these days is not that bad of an experience. So if we don't go and experience it, we never learn that. And so then we kind of get stuck in that perpetual cycle of avoidance. And finally, our body or our physical sensations box is over there on the left. And that's really where that fight, flight, or freeze comes into play. I often think of anxiety as one of the most kind of physical of emotional states, because really when we get anxious or scared, more scared than anxious, you know, for example, if a bear comes running at me, God forbid, that's going to make me scared. And I'm going to, you know, my body is going to respond. I've got there, my heart rate's going to go up so that my blood is circulating to my big muscles, which will bring oxygen to my big muscles. I'm going to breathe more quickly to give more oxygen to those big muscles so that I can either fight that bear, I can run like heck away from that bear, or in some cases we freeze and maybe even faint. And kind of from an evolutionary point of view, it might be that then the bear doesn't feel threatened, so walks away, or maybe I fall under some underbrush and I'm not seen, that sort of thing. Or if I'm near, you know, a high place, so there's something I should avoid, that freezing mechanism might stop me from going out and doing that. And so all of those things come into play when we're feeling anxious, or when we're feeling scared. The funny thing is that very same system, that fight, flight, or freeze system, kicks into gear when we're feeling anxious in our more modern urban world. So I might feel kind of anxious about an exam I'm going to write or a presentation I have to give. And that same fight, flight, or freeze, that same elevated heart rate and that same breathing and that same, you know, blood rushing away from my brain and my digestive tract to those big muscles, is all going to kick into gear. That's great when I'm running away from a bear. It's not so great when I need to give a presentation in the office. And so it's really important to kind of see that with anxiety and to understand that. And here again, we can sort of see how the cycle perpetuates itself if we are really kind of assessing life as dangerous and not thinking we're very strong, we're having those emotions, maybe we're avoiding things, or maybe we're having very strong physical responses and then misinterpreting them, thinking I'm having a heart attack or I'm off my rocker or something like that, then that leads to more thoughts. We can get really stuck in a cycle. So one of the main things we do here is we encourage people to face their fears in an organized, planful way, to go and try heading to the dentist, or maybe look at some pictures of the dentist to start. If you're working with a therapist, they'll help you kind of take steps towards that. But that's a big piece of anxiety, is avoid avoidance or start to face your fears. My name again is Thomas Brown. This has been a quick conversation about the cognitive model for anxiety. Take a look at our other content on YouTube and on our website, on our blog, as well as on Facebook and other social media platforms. We've got a lot of stuff there. Thanks so much. I look forward to talking to you again sometime very soon.